Hello, welcome here on April 18th of 2021. It's the third Sunday of Easter, and I'm Pastor Rick Stuhmer, and I'm the pastor of Tunnel and Warren Chapel United Methodist Churches outside of Marietta, Ohio, and I am so grateful that God drew you to come to this time of worship. We pray that God will speak to each of our hearts. If God kept a record of sins, who could stand before him? The Lord is forgiving and merciful. God does not hold the past against us. The Lord gives new life each day. Give praise to God, for he is just and he is merciful. His love endures forever. Come before the Lord and worship him. His love endures forever.
Rock of ages, cleft for me. Let me hide myself in thee. Let the water and the blood from thy wounded side which flowed be of sin the double cure. Save from wrath and make me pure. Not the labor of my hands can fulfill thy law's demands. Could my zeal no respite know? Could my tears forever flow? All could never sin atone. Thou must save and thou alone. Nothing in my hands I bring, simply to thy cross I cling. Naked come to thee for dress, helpless look to thee for grace. Foul I to the fountain fly, wash me, Savior, or I die.
Let us place ourselves before our God, that we may be touched and cleansed by the power of God's Spirit. Let's pray. Our great and wonderful God, it is you we come to worship. It is you that we come to praise. It is you we come to speak to, O God. It is you we come to listen to. But our worship and our praise will be stale, Lord. Our words and our thoughts will mean little if we do not see you and experience your presence with us. So, Lord God, we call on you to show yourself to us this morning. Wherever we are, let us feel your presence. Let us experience your being. Let us wonder at your greatness. Let us be humbled by your forgiveness. Let us be touched by your acceptance of us. Let us know and be filled with your grace. Let us be enveloped by your love as we share in worship and praise with you, our God. May we also share in friendship and fellowship with each other while remaining physically distanced. In Christ's name, amen and amen. Hey kids, have you ever read the book Rainbow Fish and the Big Blue Whale? There's a cover of the book in case you might remember it by the cover. Because in that book, Rainbow Fish and his friends were very happy and had lots of tiny, delicious shrimp to eat and lots of friends to play with. It was a wonderful life. And one day, a gentle old whale decided to join the fish friends. He stared at them for hours, admiring their shimmering scales and eating shrimp. And before long, some of the fish noticed that the whale was staring at them, and one of them, who was in particularly bad mood, said to the others, "Why is that old whale staring at us? Who knows what he's thinking? Look at that giant mouth. He's eating all the shrimp. What if he eats it all up, and then he comes after us?" And he called all the fish. He caused all the fish to become suspicious and afraid of the whale. And then one day the whale swam really close to the fish. And one of the fish said, look out, the wicked whale is after us. And the whale hurt him and it hurt his feelings. But then he got mad and he flipped his giant tail, scattering the fish in every direction. He chased the fish all the way back to their cave. And then the whale swam back and forth, trapping the fish in their cave. But after a while, he calmed down and he disappeared. And the fish grew hungry and they came out of the cave to eat. But all the shrimp were gone because of all that splashing and quarreling. And before, there was always enough food for everybody. But now they had nothing. And Rainbow Fish decided they must make peace with the whale. And he went to the whale and he told him their fight was all just a big mistake, and they talked for a long time. And the whale told Rainbow Fish how hurt and angry their words made him, and the fish told the whale that they were afraid because they thought the whale might eat them. And the whale told them he only watched them because their shiny scales were so pretty. And once they understood each other, they forgave each other, and the fish and the whale swam off together to find new hunting grounds. And before long, they were the best of friends. And none of them could remember what their terrible fight was all about. Sometimes we're like the rainbow fish and the whale. We get scared. We misunderstand each other. And we get our feelings hurt. So we say or we do more things that hurt each other. And a lot of times, unlike the rainbow fish, we don't take the time to talk to each other and try to figure out how to forgive each other and be friends again. Sometimes we stay angry so long we can't even remember why we were mad at each other in the first place. And we can't show the love of Jesus to anybody else as long as we're mad at each other. We need to forgive each other, and the Bible talks a lot about forgiveness. In Colossians chapter 3, verses 13 and 14, it says, "Bear with each other and forgive whatever grievances you may have against one another. Forgive as the Lord forgave you. And over all these virtues, put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity." And then Jesus was talking to Peter in Matthew 18, 11 through 22. But Peter came up to Jesus and asked, "Lord, how many times shall I forgive my brother when he sins against me? Up to seven times?" And Jesus answered, "I tell you, not seven times, but 77 times." Let us pray. Lord, help us remember everybody has had a bad day now and again. Teach us to think the best of people when people hurt us. Teach us to forgive them like Jesus forgives us. And not only that, but to not hold grudges that rob us of joy of our friendship and that joy of your fellowship. And Lord, most of all, show us how to love each other like Jesus loves us. In the name of Jesus, amen and amen. I hope you remember that story about rainbow fish and the big blue whale. It was great to have you with us, and I'm looking forward to seeing you next week. God bless you, kids. Here we are on the third Sunday of Easter, and throughout this Easter season, we are reminded that we serve a risen Savior and our prayers are heard and not just being spouted into empty air or going up and hitting the ceiling. Prayer is a dialogue with our risen Savior and our risen Lord. And as we spend time with Him, as we spend time with God, we can grow in love with Him. Prayer is also a time when we can share those things that weigh us down and let those burdens be borne by our God who is much stronger than we are. We also lift up each other's burdens to the Lord. And if you want to have someone else to come alongside you in prayer and to pray with you and for you or for your request, you can call me or you can text me at 740-304-5133. Again, that's 740-304-5133. Or you can email me at PastorRick@TunnelUMC.org. Again, that's PastorRick@TunnelUMC.org. Or you can direct message us on Facebook or Instagram. And if you request that I share these requests with our prayer warriors, and they will pray with you and for you as well, then I will share it. Otherwise, if you don't request me to share it, I'll just keep it between you and me and God and whomever else you share it with. So let us pray. How wondrous is your great forgiving love, mighty God. How wondrous is your life-giving power. With joy, we revel in the glow of the sun of this day, and we wonder at the life everlasting that you've opened up for us in raising Jesus from the dead. And as people that are born of His Spirit, we are awakened to a world that is caught still in the nightshades of sin and broken by its suffering. And here in the midst of all death, we long to bring life. We would see Jesus and we would lift Him up as a beacon of your love and promise to our world. Hear our prayers for those who are suffering this day, for the hungry and the homeless, for the sick and the imprisoned, for the angry and the lonely and the lost. We pray that you would not let our concern pass from our hearts as these words pass from our lips, but rather that you would empower us to do your work of healing and reconciliation in their lives. And we especially lift to you this day all those who are close to our hearts, whose needs are so often reminded of, and we also lift up our needs for ourselves. And as you made a fearful and disjointed band of disciples into your holy church, we pray that you would make us anew, that we, your body in your world that you created, would serve you in joy and hope and thankfulness all the days of our life together in Jesus Christ our Lord, in whose glorious name we pray. Amen and amen. Usually we close out our corporate prayer time with the Lord's Prayer. And it's found a couple of times in scriptures, once in Matthew 6 and also in Luke 11. And since we usually recite it together, you know how it goes. But right now, I don't want you to say it out loud with me. Just say it in your mind as you follow along with me. It says, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. What in the world does hallowed mean? That means to honor God's name. That means God's name is holy. May your kingdom come. May your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who have sinned against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. You may not have said that version. That was right out of Luke, but you've said that prayer many times before. But did you catch that verse right there in the middle of the prayer? Forgive us our sins as we forgive others. I mean, Luke 11:4, in the middle of the Lord's Prayer is that little phrase, forgive us our sins just as we forgive those who sin against us. It's easy to say, but why is it so hard? I mean, it's one thing to ask God to forgive us. That's what we talked about a couple of weeks ago on Easter. Last week, we talked about forgiving ourselves because sometimes, even though we know God has forgiven us, we have a hard time forgiving ourselves. And today, we're talking about one of the most difficult issues of forgiveness. How do you forgive others? The Bible says, just as God has forgiven us, then we also must forgive others. This is tough stuff. This is hard to do. I think one of the reasons it's so hard to forgive others is because of a misunderstanding about what forgiving others really is. So here's what forgiving others is not. Number one, forgiving others is not justifying their actions. If you've been harmed in the past, if you need forgiveness from someone, you don't have to justify their actions. You don't have to say things like, well, they were under a lot of stress. Well, I certainly don't think they meant it that way. Or forgiving others is not justifying their actions. And forgiving others, secondly, is not trusting the passage of time. Have you ever heard the myth that time heals all wounds? The passage of time doesn't make things better. It doesn't bring about healing. It doesn't make things better. Time just passes away. So it's not just trusting the passage of time. And third, forgiving others is not denying that you were hurt. It's not saying, oh, it didn't hurt. It didn't matter. I didn't notice anything. It didn't affect me. If you're a guy, we're good at this. We're tough. We're rugged. Nobody hurts us. I'm not hurt. I didn't feel a thing during that. But when someone hurts you, it's like getting a splinter in your finger. Have you ever had that? It may be really small, and every time you brush over it, you feel it, but you just deny that it's there. And if you continue to deny that it's there, it's going to set up infection, and it's going to eventually harm your whole hand. And that little splinter can eventually harm not just your hand, but your whole body if it's ignored long enough. So forgiveness is not denying that you were hurt. And number four, forgiving others is not confronting them personally. It's not going to them and grabbing them by the shirt and saying, give me an apology. Forgiveness is not seeking revenge and getting in their face as much as we want to do that when someone hurts us. Forgiveness is not any of these things. So what does it mean to really forgive others? How can we forgive others just as God has forgiven us? For those answers, let's go to Scripture. The Bible says a lot about forgiveness. In fact, it lays out very clearly a process that we can walk through to find freedom in forgiving others. And as we look at this process today, I want to challenge you to personalize the process. Don't let this be an abstract intellectual exercise or something that I hear and don't put into practice later. Instead, experience the true freedom of forgiveness. Think of someone you need to forgive and personalize this process. Keep them in your mind as we walk through the steps of learning to forgive others. The first step in learning to forgive others is remember. Remember how much I've been forgiven. Remember how much I've been forgiven is how that should be said, because the first step in forgiving others is to understand how much God has forgiven you. How much has God forgiven you? A lot. He's forgiven me a lot. Remember a couple of weeks ago when we talked about the prodigal son? It's the most famous short story in the Bible. The story of the prodigal son is actually my story. It's actually your story. We are the prodigal son, or we are the prodigal daughter who has turned our back on our loving father. We have gone our own way. We have enjoyed sin for a season, and yet when we return home, God welcomes us back, and God forgives us, not just partially, but God forgives us completely. God doesn't make us pay it back. He forgives us freely. So when we have to be reminded over and over, that's because we are human. Because as humans, we have this amazing capacity to forget. We forget just how good we have it. We forget how completely and fully and how freely God has forgiven us. We are the prodigal child. We've sinned. We've lost the right to be forgiven. We can do nothing to earn God's forgiveness. God doesn't demand an apology from us, but he will wipe us clean if we turn to him. Isaiah 1:18, such a great verse because it talks about God's complete forgiveness. Notice what it says. Come, let's talk this over, says the Lord. No matter how deep the stain of your sin, I can take it out and make you as clean as freshly fallen snow. Even if you were stained as red as crimson, I can make you white as wool. Before we can go any further in this process of understanding how to forgive others, we must first understand how much God has forgiven us. We must remember we are the ones who went to God with this crimson stain on our souls, and God totally forgave us. Why? Because God offers his forgiveness, not conditionally, but unconditionally. It is so important that we remember. That's step number one. You have to get this step down first, because only forgiven people can forgive others. Maybe one of the reasons that it has been so hard for you to forgive another person is because you haven't fully understood how much God has forgiven you, how much you have been forgiven by God. But before we look at step two, let's take a moment to reflect on how much we have been forgiven as we listen about God's amazing love. As we listen, open your minds and say two things to God. God, remind me during this song how much I've been forgiven. And secondly, God, bring to mind the name of someone who I need to forgive. And help me personalize this process. Let's pray. Father, in this moment, as we listen and we think about the cross and think about how you have taken our crimson stained sin and how you've totally forgiven us, help it to be more than just words on our lips or thoughts in our minds, but help us to put it into practice in our hearts. Help us truly experience it, not just in our heads, but in our hearts. God, we want to remember just how much we have been forgiven. Then God, just as you have forgiven us, teach us how to forgive others. We pray this all together. Amen and amen.
I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted, you were condemned. And I'm alive and well, your spirit is within me because you died and rose again. I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted, you were condemned. I'm alive and well, your spirit is within me because you died and rose again.
Did you reflect just on how much you've been forgiven? Did God make it real to you? Did you think of someone you need to forgive? Now let's bring those two things together. Jesus tells a story that's sometimes called the parable of the unforgiving servant. It's found in Matthew 18. It's the story of a king who is owed a lot of money. And the king decided to call in the people who were in debt to him and make them pay. So the first guy that the king calls in is a guy who owed him millions of dollars. So the guy who owes the millions comes before the king, and the king says, "You owe me millions of dollars. Pay up." And the guy says, "I don't have the money." So the king says, I'll throw you, your wife, and your children in prison. That's what they did in those days. It's kind of like what we do these days if you ever miss a credit card payment. The guy who owed the millions fell on his knees before the king and said, King, oh king, be patient with me and I will pay it all back. First of all, he was probably telling a lie because millions of dollars in those days would have been more than the gross national product of that nation. He certainly wouldn't have been able to pay it back. But look at what the king did. The king was filled with pity for the man, and he released him and forgave his debt, saying, Don't worry about paying me back. You're free. He had pity on him. The man who was in debt left the king and was walking down the street when he sees a guy who owes him a few thousand dollars. And this man goes up to him and he grabs the person who owes him a few thousand dollars by the throat and he begins to shake him, shaking the money out of him. And by the way, it was legal in those days too. If someone owed you money and you saw them on the street, you had the right to take revenge. So he begins to shake him by the throat. The guy who owed thousands of dollars fell down and says to him, Dear sir, be patient with me and I will pay it back. But his creditor wouldn't wait. And he had the man arrested and jailed and thrown into debtor's prison along with his wife and children. And the word got back to the king. The king heard what had happened and he was very upset. And the king went to the man whom he had forgiven millions. And this is where we pick up the story in Matthew 18, 32 and 35 through 35. It says, Then the king called in the man he had forgiven and said, You evil servant, I forgave you that tremendous debt because you pleaded with me. Shouldn't you have had mercy on your fellow servant just as I had mercy on you? And then the angry king sent the man to prison until he had paid every penny. And the story ends there. But Jesus continues to comment and says, That's what my heavenly Father will do to you if you refuse to forgive your brothers and sisters in your hearts. That's some strong language. You have somebody in mind that you need to forgive? More than likely you do. Probably the very moment we started this message today, you thought of someone. You had a picture in your mind. You began to play the tape of how they had hurt you. Perhaps it was someone who had committed an infidelity towards you. Perhaps it was a lover or a spouse that had hurt you. Perhaps it was a parent who abused you or molested you. Perhaps it was a friend who betrayed you, or perhaps it was someone at work who unjustly criticized you. What are we talking about? It's very personal. How do you forgive others? Even though it may be a bit painful, as we continue to walk through this process, I want you to personalize it. I want you to think of someone you need to forgive and think about how you can apply this process to that situation. And the first step is to remember how much I have been forgiven. And here's the key to the whole process, and it's step number two. After you have remembered, now it's time to release. Release the person entirely. The person who you are thinking about in your mind, release them entirely. What does it mean, release? It means to set them free. It means to no longer hold on to the bitterness or the resentment. It means to stop playing with those tapes in your mind of the incident where they harmed you and playing them over and over and over and over again in your mind. It means to fully let go, to drop the grudge, to release a person means that you don't have to confront them, repair, or even reconcile, because releasing is all about your decision. You don't even have to be in a conversation with the other person to release them. You can choose to release them. Forgiveness is always a choice. Forgiveness is not an emotion. It's a choice. In this step of the process, you make the choice to forgive them. And when you make that choice, tremendous freedom is yours. A lot of you, instead of releasing a person, you're holding a grudge towards a person. You got any grudges in your life? Holding a grudge is like drinking poison and hoping the other person will get sick. Have you ever done that? Have you ever held a grudge? Are you ready to release that person? Do you want to leave this time that we are gathered together free and experiencing the joy that God wants to give you when you forgive others? You probably understand this intellectually. You have it there in your head. The idea that you should release others, but have you ever done that emotionally? Have you ever worked this process of releasing a person emotionally? That can be difficult. Let me give you a couple of practical ways that you can release a person entirely. They're not necessarily biblical ways or anti-biblical ways. These are some ways that psychologists have taught us that we can release a person. In psychology, they teach that one of the things that you can do is you can take out a piece of paper and you can write a letter to the person who's offended you, or call up a document in your computer and type out that message. And in that letter, you can say whatever you want to. You can say how much they hurt you. You can say how it felt. You can say all that stuff that you want to say if you ever had the chance. You can write it all down, but at the end of that letter, you say that you release them. You say that you are setting them free, that you're no longer going to hold this against them, that you're not going to hold a grudge. And then you take that letter and you fold it, or you save it in a file folder on your computer, and you put it away. You never mail it. You never send it to them. It goes in a drawer somewhere or on file somewhere in your computer, but it's your release papers. As silly as that might sound, it does work. Other times it's taught that you can sometimes sit down with someone and have an imaginary conversation. There in your room, you can pull out a second chair and you can pretend that that person is in that chair, and you can have this conversation as a cathartic release of an imaginary dialogue that allows you to release them. Other psychologists teach that you can take a picture of that person who has harmed you, and you can put that on the chair, or you can just lay it there in front of you and you can have a conversation with that picture. This process of setting someone free, of releasing them, is the key to the freedom that God wants you to experience through forgiveness. And when you release someone, whether it is this chair or this letter or any other process, what you are doing is saying, I'm giving up my rights. Your rights to what? When you fully release a person, what are you doing? You are giving up the right to repayment. When somebody harms us, we think that they now are in debt to us because they harmed us and they now owe us. They have to repay us for the wrong that they have done. But when you release the person, you're releasing your right to repayment. You are saying, that person no longer owes me anything. I am releasing them from that debt. Just like the king released the debt in the story of the person who owed him millions of dollars. Second, are you releasing your rights to revenge? Secondly, you're releasing your rights to revenge. The right to revenge. So when someone harms you, it's natural you want to get revenge. You want to let them have it. But when you fully release them, you're saying, no longer am I going to seek revenge. You don't have to seek revenge, because revenge is not your job. God says that he'll take care of that. Romans 12, 17 through 19 says, never pay back evil for evil to anyone. Do things in such a way that everyone can see that you're honorable. Dear friends, never avenge yourselves. Leave that to God, for it is written, I will take vengeance. I will repay those who deserve it, says the Lord. So when it comes to this issue of release, you will either release them once and be done with it for the rest of your life, or you will rehearse that episode of pain for all of your life. That's what it comes down to. Either release it and release that person, or rehearse the hurt and the bitterness over and over and over again. You have the choice. Forgiveness is always a choice. And once you take the big step of releasing them, you are ready for step number three, recognizing God's purpose in the process. You can't recognize God's purpose in the process until you first release that person. If you try to do it in the reverse, it just leads to confusion. And some of us have tried that. Some of you have said, God, if you'll just show me your purpose for this pain or this hurt, I will be able to release them. However, God says, no, you have to release them first. You have to take the action that you can take first. It's only after you release someone that you will have the freedom to understand my purpose. Because when you're holding a grudge, you are separating yourself from God and He can't speak to you properly. When you release that person, you not only release them, you have opened the doors between you and God, and He can now teach you. So He can now show you His purpose for this pain. In the last three chapters of Genesis, chapters 47 through 50, God teaches us a story of how He can bring good out of evil. It's the story of Joseph. Many of you are familiar with it. When Joseph was just a child, not even a teenager, he is out in the desert playing with his brothers, and a band of thieves come along, and the brothers have this sinful idea of selling their brother into slavery. And that's what they do. They take the brother and they sell him to the thieves, and they pocket the money. And when they get back home to Dad, they say, "Dad, you're not going to believe this, but Joseph is dead." Bad situation. As things would happen, Joseph eventually goes from bad to worse. He ends up in prison. And there in prison, he interprets dreams. And because he's a person who understands some of the supernatural things in the world, during that day, he begins to rise to power. And out of that bad situation, some good things are going to happen in Joseph's life. While we aren't told it directly in Scripture, over the course of time, Joseph begins to release his brothers. He lets go of the grudge, any grudge towards his brothers. Because of that new freedom he has experienced, he continues to rise and rise and rise until the country next door to where his family lives, he becomes the right-hand man of the ruler. And as fate would have it, in that long story towards the end of the book of Genesis, the next door nation fell into hard times and famine came into the land, and they decided to send some emissaries from the nation to the nation that had plenty of food. And guess who they sent? They sent Joseph's brothers. Imagine the story, if you will, from the neighboring country. Joseph's brothers come over to beg for food, and they are now sitting before the right-hand man of the ruler, who they don't know is their little brother. He recognizes them. He has released them. It takes them for a while for them to recognize him, but when they do, something very interesting happens in chapter 50 of Genesis. "But Joseph told them, 'Don't be afraid of me.'" Well, they should have been. He was the right-hand man. He could have taken all their lives right then and there. It says, "Don't be afraid of me. Am I God to judge and to punish you? As far as I'm concerned, God turned into good what you meant for evil. He brought me to this high position that I have today so that I can save lives of many people." Note the phrase, "God turned it into good." It doesn't say that God called it good. It doesn't say that God named it good. It says God turned it into good. That's the miracle of forgiveness. When you and I release another person in that bad situation, we can still recognize God's purpose. And He will take something bad and He will turn it into good. Joseph recognized that. I know some of you are listening have gone through some really tough stuff. I'm constantly amazed as a pastor to hear some of the sinful situations that people in our church have gone through. And people have harmed you. I don't know what purpose God will bring out of that situation. But I know that if you follow this biblical process, that He will. God will turn into good something that someone else meant for evil. God can birth purpose out of pain. God can birth ministry out of misery. God can bring healing out of hurts. That's the miracle of biblical process of forgiveness. And that brings us to our next step. And number four is conditional. 1 through 3 are mandatory. Number four is conditional. Step number four in God's process of forgiving others is reestablish the relationship as much as possible. We'll talk about that. But before we do, let me recommend a resource. One of the things that really has helped me in this area of forgiveness is the book, The Gift of Forgiveness by Dr. Charles Stanley. And some of what I'm sharing about how far do you go in reestablishing a relationship comes from his book. And you can pick it up on Amazon.com. or probably another bookstore somewhere. It's fairly old, but it's a good book. It's a good read, and it helps you in the midst of learning about forgiveness. And one of the things that this book taught me as it took me through the scriptural understanding of forgiveness is that forgiveness and reconciliation are not the same. Have you ever heard that forgiveness and reconciliation are not the same? Forgive, forget, restore, they're all different things. Forgiveness and reconciliation are not the same. There's times when you should not reconcile. There's times when you should not reestablish that relationship. For example, don't reestablish the relationship. It's going to lead to additional personal harm. God gives you the choice to decide. He never says you have to reestablish that relationship. You get to use your own wisdom to decide and be led by the Spirit of God. Whether you can reestablish the relationship or not, you must release them. You must look for God's purpose. And then the Bible says if you can't reestablish the relationship, what you can do is begin to act toward the person in good ways. Romans 12:21 says, don't let evil get the best of you, but conquer evil by doing evil. No. That's not what it says. Let me read it right. I mean, two wrongs don't make a right. So first take evil and conquer evil with evil. That's not what the Bible teaches. It says, don't let evil get the best of you, but conquer evil by doing good. Don't let evil get the best of you, but conquer evil by doing good. What does it mean? It means even if you can't reestablish your relationship, still act in a good way towards that person. You might have to do this privately. Not publicly, but privately. You begin to change the way you think, and you think good thoughts about that person. You begin to pray, not God's vengeance, but God's blessing on that person. You begin to look for ways you might be able to act in a positive way toward that person. You may decide to stop talking about the situation. Say, I'm going to let it go because I've assassinated this person's character enough. Now I'm going to act in a good way towards them and just drop it. Biblically, it's okay not to restore the relationship. If you have forgiven the offender, if you have released the person, if you are following the process that we're talking about today, then you should feel no guilt and no shame that the relationship hasn't been fully restored. It's okay not to restore the relationship, and there are even times when we shouldn't. Romans 12:18 says, do your part to live in peace with everyone as much as possible. Here it says two interesting things. Number one, it says, do your part. What does that mean? Do your part. You can't force the other person to release you, but if you can do your part by releasing them. You can't force the other person to discover God's purpose, but you can do your part in discovering God's purpose. Do your part. Do the side of the equation that you can do. Then it says, as much as possible. If possible, if it's not possible, skip this step and move on to number five. And number five is repeat the process. Have you ever read the back of the shampoo bottle? It's kind of funny what it says. It says, wash, rinse, repeat. This process of forgiveness is the same way. You're going to go through this process for the rest of your life. You've been thinking about one person that you need to forgive. And as we leave our time together today, I'm going to invite you to type the initials of that person in the comment section of this worship, which again will act as our wall of forgiveness. And as you do, forgive them. And that's just one person. Unless you have lived in a really sheltered life or in a bubble, there's more than one person in your past. You're going to have to repeat this process. Take the steps and find forgiveness. Even if you forgive everyone in your past, there are going to be more people in your future because we live in this fallen world. Matthew 18, just before Jesus told that story about the king and the million-dollar debt, Peter came to Jesus. Maybe there had been some grudges between the disciples. Maybe there had been some hard feelings among the disciples And Peter, whom I love, comes to Jesus and says, Jesus, how many times do we have to forgive another person? In that day, the law said 7 times. And Jesus' response in Matthew 18:22 says, 70 times 7. Now, some of you mathematicians just multiplied that and said that's 490. I've got it 490 times, but that's not what Jesus was talking about. What Jesus was saying is, how many times should you forgive others? How many times do you want God to forgive you? That's the answer. How many times do you want God to forgive you? Listen, there are things in my life that I've done wrong thousands of times and had to go to God and ask Him to forgive me. What if I went to Him and He said, Rick, I'm sorry, you're out of luck. That's number 491. End of story. But He doesn't do that. Instead, no matter how many times I go to God, whatever I ask God for forgiveness, He forgives me every time. Every time. So when we're hurt by other people and we go to God and say, God, how many times do I have to forgive them? 70 times 7 in God's math is not 490. It's every time. Every time. Every time. I know this is hard. But some of the strongest teaching in the Bible is around this principle that our forgiveness by God is connected to our forgiveness of others. In Matthew chapter 6, verses 14 and 15, Jesus says, if you forgive those who sin against you, your heavenly Father will forgive you. But if you refuse to forgive others, your Father will not forgive your sins. This is one of 4 times when we hear this statement in the Gospels. And it's strong language. This is a big issue. God desires what's best for you. God says that the only way that you can experience His best for you is to forgive others. When it comes to forgiving others, forgiveness is a choice. It's not an emotion, it's a choice. And today you have a choice. On one side of the equation, you can choose to hold on to your grudges. You can choose to hold on to your desire for revenge. And you can let bitterness run wild in your life. Bitterness can be the choice that you choose. God will not force you. It's up to you. You can choose bitterness. But you should know if you allow bitterness to run wild in your life, it will manifest itself in some amazingly unhealthy ways. It'll manifest itself in high blood pressure, short temper, irritability, sleeplessness, obsession with getting even. Bitterness will manifest itself in depression, isolation, negative attitudes, and a general feeling of disease or dis-ease. That's been proven over and over and over again, not just biblically, but medically, that if you choose bitterness, it'll hurt you. Or you can choose to forgive another person. And you can find freedom. You can find release. You can find peace with God and with others. You can find health. You can find joy. You can find love modeled at a higher level. In general, when you choose to forgive, you're saying, God, take me to a higher level of living. Make me more like You. But the choice is up to you. And my challenge to you today is to choose freedom. Choose to forgive. Release the person that you've been holding on to. Drop the grudges. Take the action necessary. Experience the freedom. Experience the freedom that is described in Ephesians chapter 4:32. Be kind and loving to each other and forgive others just as God forgave you in Christ. The ultimate proof that you have forgiven someone else is when you can honestly go to God in prayer and tell Him that you have forgiven that person. And I'm going to lead us in a prayer in a minute, and I want you to be ready and with the person's name and what they did to you, and we'll fill in the blanks during that prayer. And I'm not going to tell you what to pray specifically about that person, but I'll pause a moment and let you express that to God. And if you're ready to experience that freedom, let's pray this prayer with me and release the other person. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank You for how much You have forgiven me. Today, I forgive and say the person in your heart that you're forgiving. God, I'm forgiving them for, now tell God what it is. He already knows, but there's something about saying it that releases that person. And you say it to, out loud or quietly to him in your heart. Continue to pray. God, show me the action I need to take to reestablish the relationship if it's possible. And help me to forgive others as much as you have forgiven me. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Now I want to invite you to go beyond just a spiritual exercise of this prayer. And what happens in prayer is very real. But I want you to take some practical steps. And as you exit our time together, I want you to type the initials or initial of a person you're forgiving in the comments section is our virtual wall of forgiveness. And then spiritually, physically, and emotionally, leave this time knowing that you found the freedom of forgiveness. The choice is up to you to engage in this exercise or not. Those initials that you type there are your statement. They're your signature of forgiveness, if you will.
Sins as we forgive, you taught us, Lord, to pray. But you alone can grant us grace to live the words we say. How can your pardon reach and bless the unforgiving?
Let love be genuine. Hate what is evil. Hold fast to what is good. Love one another with deep affection, thinking of others more highly than yourself. Serve the Lord with zeal. Rejoice in hope. Be patient in suffering. Persevere in prayer. Forgive as you were forgiven. And may our Lord Jesus Christ himself and God our Father, who loves us and by his grace gave us eternal encouragement and good hope, encourage our hearts and strengthen you in every good deed and every good word. Amen and amen.
forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted. You were condemned. And I'm alive and well. Your spirit is within me because you died and rose again. I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted.